check in and you're taking a nap.
Ah! Okay.
So, you want to learn about spin, huh? Then you've come to the right place. Probably. This channel has been known to focus a bit on spin. So far, my videos on spin are very different. One is fairly approachable and shows the geometry of Pauli spinners, while the other is pretty much a wall of algebraic spellcraft. It is my hope to now give another approachable video explaining what spin is intuitively and geometrically. Then, using this geometric definition, I will derive the Schrödinger equation. Note that this video will present everything using the mathematics of geometric algebra. I will have a section in this video covering the basics of geometric algebra, but if you want to learn more, then make sure to check out my other videos on the subject and to join my Discord server. All links will be in the description. But before we start, this video is self-sponsored through my Patreon. If you like the video or my content, a great and simple way to show support is to subscribe as a $1 a month patron. Doing so grants access to ceremonial roles in my Discord server, as well as access to some of my math and physics notes. A special thanks to my current only patron, Grungus. Yes, Grungus is a free patron and therefore has not pledged money, but his name is Grungus, and I think that's enough.
As always, if you ended up liking this video, or if you end up liking this video, please make sure to like and subscribe in order to show YouTube I'm actually relevant. Without further ado, let's get into it.
This video will be divided into two main parts, an intro to the geometric algebra of physical space, and spin as rotational invariance. If you're familiar with geometric algebra as well as my notation, then feel free to skip to the timestamp on screen. The foundation of the geometric algebra approach can be associated with the geometric product. The geometric product allows for the multiplication of two vectors and is the sum of the inner and the outer product between the vectors. The inner product is just the familiar vector dot product and returns a scalar value. The outer product is actually related to the vector cross product, as I will show shortly, but instead of returning a vector, it returns a new object called a bivector. The bivector is the oriented plane spanned by the vectors A and B. The specific algebra we will use is the algebra of physical space, which has the following orthonormal basis. There is one unit scalar and one unit pseudoscalar. There are three unit vectors and three unit bivectors. A general vector A can be represented as a linear combination of the unit vectors sigma x, y, and z. Likewise, a general bivector B can be represented as a linear combination of the unit bivectors sigma x, y, y, z, and zx. A very interesting thing in the algebra of physical space is that the pseudoscalar, which is the product of all three unit vectors, squares to negative 1 and commutes with all elements, so it can be called the imaginary unit and is then labeled I. This allows us to rewrite the basis bivectors as I times the basis vectors. This concept is called duality and allows us to then rewrite bivectors as the pseudoscalar times a vector. Note that this vector is perpendicular to the plane described by the bivector. Returning to the outer product of two vectors, we can use the fact that a bivector is the pseudoscalar times some perpendicular vector to solve for this vector n. This is actually the cross product. So, one reason why geometric algebra is so useful is because it generalizes the approaches in traditional vector mechanics. Another incredibly useful tool in the geometric algebra shed is the concept of rotors. If you're interested in a fuller derivation and visualization of rotors, then make sure to check out my video, All Motion is Reflection. In this video, I'll simply motivate the idea of rotors by the geometric product. What I mean is that the product of two unit vectors can be viewed as a rotation in the plane generated by the bivector A, wedge B. Another way to say this is that the product of A and B can be viewed as a rotation around the axis defined by the unit vector n. Traditionally, we label this quantity r and call it a rotor. It's not the point of this video to prove this, but a rotor rotates any object in the algebra via what's called a sandwich product. This actually ends up rotating by twice the angle theta, so we usually perform a change of variables from theta to some angle omega over 2 and add a minus sign for convention. An important property of rotors is that they transform via one-sided transformations. That is, when an object is rotated once and then a second rotation is applied, it looks like the first rotor is transformed by multiplying the first rotor by the second rotor on the left-hand side. For those already familiar with the basics of spin, this should look eerily familiar. Before we go to the next section, it's an interesting side note that one of the matrix representations for the algebra of physical space is the Pauli representation, which uses the Pauli matrices. Again, this is yet another great tool available within geometric algebra. So, the derivation for the Schrödinger equation that I will present is not mathematically novel, but I will note that I have not seen it in this context, that is the context of the Schrödinger equation, within the literature. I suspect it already exists somewhere, so if anyone has seen this same approach, I'd greatly appreciate a comment on the video or a ping on my Discord server. After reading a bunch of references on spinners and trying to use geometric algebra to describe spin, the definition of spin that my brain eventually landed on is that the intrinsic spin of a fermion is the existence of a rotational invariance within its rest frame. Specifically, this is a spin 2 invariance. For those unfamiliar with invariants under spin groups, imagine three circles which represent the three different planes of rotation in 3D space. For simplicity, we'll assume that each plane corresponds to each basis bivector. The group that represents arbitrary rotations via some arbitrary composition of rotations in each plane is called the spin 3 group. A point particle is invariant under rotations in spin 3, or said otherly, a point particle is invariant under rotations in three-dimensional space. This makes sense because no matter how I rotate a point, it still looks like a point. But spin 2 is a different story. Effectively, spin 2 is the group of rotations in two-dimensional space. In two-dimensional space, two of these rotational degrees of freedom collapse, and there is now only one plane in which rotation can occur. So fermions have a property that breaks the spin 3 invariance, which thereby collapses to a spin 2 invariance. This property is called its intrinsic spin. This is effectively equivalent to stating that there is some sort of axis. For simplicity, we will call this the spin axis, and also for simplicity, we will say that it's the z direction basis vector. The intrinsic spin can then be represented by the rotor, which leaves this spin axis unchanged. We will also assume that this rotor is proper time dependent. Now, a rotor that leaves a vector invariant within an odd dimensional geometric algebra is called a pointer, so we will call this rotor the spin pointer. Now, before we fully begin the derivation of the Schrödinger equation, there are three important things that must be pointed out slash defined. The first is the derivative with respect to time, because we'll be using it. The second is that the spin 2 invariance implies that the spin axis commutes with the spin pointer. And the third is to recall that when composing rotation, rotors transform via one-sided transformations. Now let's officially begin the derivation. The location of a particle is given by a proper time-independent probability density, rho. In general, rho can be complex, but for simplicity, we will stick with a real-valued probability density. Now, we suppose this particle is a fermion by associating the probability density with a spin axis. This automatically implies the existence of a spin pointer. We can then split the probability density into two square roots and relabel the scaled pointers. Notice that there is now a psi dagger. In the algebra of physical space, there is an operation called reversion, which reverses product order. It turns out that the inverse of r-naught is its reversion, so when we relabel the square root of rho times r-naught as psi-naught, we use the dagger instead. In this case, it is fully equivalent to the Hermitian conjugate. The next step is to consider the change in proper time of the scaled spin pointer, psi-naught. We can then multiply by I on both sides and by sigma z on both sides, which puts this equation in nearly the final form. Finally, we rotate the pointer via the one-sided transformation in order to obtain a classical Pauli spinner, and we also invoke the Planck-Einstein relation. This gives us the Schrödinger equation in the geometric algebra of physical space, An interesting thing to note is that rather than identifying quantum operators, like in the traditional formalism, the correct equation falls out simply from the geometry. For those of you unfamiliar with geometric algebra, I could understand you also being confused about the vector sigma z existing on the right-hand side of the Schrödinger equation. The traditional formalism Schrödinger equation can be recovered by the introduction of a projector F, which absorbs the sigma z. The interpretation and use of this projector is more thoroughly discussed in my Pauli spinner video, so I recommend that you watch that. However, one neat result is that applying the projector to the spin pointer results in the time evolution operator from the traditional Schrödinger formalism. Thank you for watching this video. I sincerely hope it was able to help and potentially even give a new perspective on things. If so, a like, comment, and subscription are excellent ways to show your support. Till next time, when I show how this approach works for deriving the Dirac equation.